It is now time for a question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Royal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Across the province, when seniors open their hydro bills, they are shocked. Shocked that they might not be able to afford to pay their hydro bill. The same people that built this province as Canada's economic engine have had their government turn their back on them as energy prices skyrocketed. Those seniors have watched Ontario sadly become a have-not province. They worry about keeping the lights on in face of energy bills that have risen by over $1,000 on the watch of this government. Mr. Speaker, why does the Premier care so little about Ontario's seniors?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And as I have said before in this House, I hope that when the issue of electricity prices is raised with any member of this House, that they point to the programs that have been put in place specifically to help folks who are perhaps struggling to pay their bills, Mr. Speaker. So we've put in place the Ontario Electricity Support Program, and that's a program that will help low to modest income families save on average $360 a year, Mr. Speaker. We have put in place on the industrial side the industrial electricity incentive, industrial conservation initiative, Mr. Speaker, and there is a property tax and seniors rate, Mr. Speaker, that seniors can apply for. So I hope that the Leader of the Opposition points people who raise this issue with him to those programs.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, my question is once again for the Premier. When I think of the billing scandal at Hydro One, I'm often reminded of that citizen from Timmins, that senior who saw $10,000 taken from his account incorrectly by Hydro One. Seniors on fixed incomes, who, in the words of the Ombudsman, were mistreated, abused, were victims of deceit and deception. Mr. Speaker, how can the Premier callously ignore the needs of Ontario seniors because of her reckless energy policy?
So, Mr. Speaker, I take it the argument that the Leader of the Opposition is making is that Hydro One could be a better-run company. I hear in his question the assumption that it should be a better-run company. And, Mr. Speaker, the motivation for broadening the ownership of Hydro One is to invest in infrastructure. That is our starting point, Mr. Speaker. But the reality is this is a company that can be better run, that can, with professional board, Mr. Speaker, and leadership, Mr. Speaker, it can be a better run company. And I would say to the Leader of the Opposition,
I hope I do not have to employ yesterday's strategy, but I will. Please finish.
Leader of the Opposition, to remind him of what he said on May the 15th of this year, and I quote, I generally believe that the private sector can do a better job than the public
sector.
I generally think market conditions would be helpful for a lot of government agencies, unquote. I assume he means Hydro One in this case, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, again for the Premier, in this very chamber, the minister responsible for seniors, the Premier's Liberal MPP for York West, on the topic of the Hydro One privatization, said, I quote, we should try to protect this wonderful facility, which, if sold, will not come back to the hands of the people of Ontario anymore. We will be at their mercy. Once again, we will have no recourse, no control with respect to the rates, and they will go high. It must be hard. It must be hard for the minister responsible for seniors to look seniors in the eye and tell them that this deal is good. Why won't the Premier listen to her own cabinet ministers? Why won't the Premier listen to seniors? Mr. Speaker, why does the Premier proceed with this hydro fire sale, callously ignoring the wishes of Ontario seniors?
Thank you. Be seated. Be seated, please. Thank you.
Points in the debate around issues in a caucus, there are obviously different opinions. And, Mr. Speaker, I know that the Leader of the Opposition has that situation in his own caucus. We have very, very active debates, Mr. Speaker, within our caucus, and that's healthy. That is very, very healthy for democracy. I welcome those debates within my caucus, Mr. Speaker. I think that's how we make good decisions. I think it's how we hear the perspectives from around the province. We made a decision, Mr. Speaker, that we were going to review our assets. Ed Clark.
I will now employ yesterday's strategy. Warnings are headed your way.
Ed Clark and his team of experts, Mr. Speaker, helped us to look at the assets of this province in
Answer.
Order to leverage them. We've made a decision that investing in infrastructure in this province
Remember from
is
Nipissing
critical
is warned.
For the future economic well-being of Ontario.
Thank you. New question. The Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Over the summer, the City of Windsor lost a bid for the new Jaguar Land Rover plant. The Mayor of Windsor, when asked what he could have done differently, what Windsor could have done differently, he said, the mayor said, it wasn't Windsor, it wasn't Essex County, it wasn't our region. There were other factors beyond our control that created a competitive disadvantage. The factors outside of Windsor that created the competitive disadvantage were the policies of this Liberal government.
Minister of Economic Development is warned. Carry on, please.
Mr. Speaker, these conditions created by the Liberal government are killing jobs in Ontario. Mr. Speaker, when will the Premier change her approach to make sure we create a competitive economy in Ontario?
So, Mr. Speaker, the 15,000 jobs that were...
Oh. Dufferin-Caledon is warned. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, in the last 7 months, 15,000 new manufacturing jobs in Ontario, Mr. Speaker. 2 years in a row. 2 years in a row, Ontario has been the number one jurisdiction for foreign direct investment, Mr. Speaker. The investments that we are making, the conditions that we are creating in Ontario, the supports that we are giving to industry, whether it is in electricity rates, Mr. Speaker, to allow them to have a reduced rate so that they can be more competitive, Mr. Speaker, or whether it's the direct supports that, quite frankly, the opposition has always objected to, Mr. Speaker. They have never supported the notion that we need to partner with business and make
Answer.
Sure that we allow them to thrive, allow them to expand, allow them to become advanced manufacturers in the case of manufacturing.
Thank you.
That's the kind of condition that we're creating.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again for the Premier, no one is asking for a handout. They just want the sector to be competitive in Ontario. The reality is we've lost 43,000 auto jobs on the watch of this government. Windsor is a city that relies on manufacturing jobs. Instead of listening to municipalities, the Premier is making it harder and harder for municipalities to compete. Now the Premier wants to hammer municipalities with not only skyrocketing energy prices, but the cap and trade tax, the payroll tax. So my question is, why does the Premier continue to make it impossible for municipalities and cities like Windsor to succeed?
You know, Mr. Speaker, I very much value our good working relationship with the municipalities of this province. There are 444 municipalities, Mr. Speaker. Our ministers and our members travel the province. We meet with municipal leaders, Mr. Speaker. I believe that it is extremely important for the provincial government to have a good open working relationship with the municipalities, which is why we have put in place, for example, Mr. Speaker, the Communities Infrastructure Fund that is a direct result of feedback that we got from municipalities on the need to invest in roads and bridges. It's why there's a new Connecting Links program, Mr. Speaker, to deal with the realities of roads that municipalities can't afford to keep up, and we need that support. Mr. Speaker, the member opposite is part of a party that has not supported the relationship that we have with municipalities.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, it's not about photo ops around the province, whether it's in Windsor or Oshawa or any plant in between. It's the responsibility of government to create the conditions to be competitive, to create the conditions to create jobs. You have heard me say again and again that the auto sector is as important to Ontario as oil is to Alberta or potash is to Saskatchewan. Yet for 12 years, the Liberal government has made it harder and harder for the auto sector to succeed in Ontario. Now it's being reported that the Buicks won't be made at GM in Oshawa after 2017. So, Mr. Speaker, my question for the Premier is, has she entirely given up on the auto sector and manufacturing in Ontario?
You see it, please.
Thank you. Premier.
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Mr. Speaker, this party will never give up on the auto sector in this province. We'll continue to make the investments that we need to make. But the party that that member purports to lead gave up on the auto sector in 2009.
I'm going to remind all members again, but you have on your desk a reminder. You're speaking to the chair.
Absolutely, Mr. Speaker, through you to the party opposite.
That is not appropriate. You're speaking to the chair, just to me. You're not Spock speaking to them.
Okay, Mr. Speaker. I'm not sure how to respond to that, except to say, Mr. Speaker, we have made $1.6 billion of investment, Mr. Speaker, in manufacturing. That's brought $15 billion of investment to this province. 60,000 manufacturing jobs. I beseech the member opposite, Mr. Speaker. Look around you at the members around you. None of them, Mr. Speaker.
You see it? You see it, please? The purpose of my interjection was to allow us to bring the temperature down. It's not helpful when others continue to make it rise. New question. The Leader of the Third.
Speaker. Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. The people of Ontario own Hydro One, but the Premier is plowing ahead with a privatization scheme and keeping owners in the dark, Speaker. She's held no public consultations and no public hearings. She's eliminated oversight by our watchdogs like the Auditor General, and she's shed no light whatsoever on any evidence at all to back up her scheme. Speaker, why is this Premier determined to sell off Hydro One with no transparency, no public scrutiny by the people of Ontario?
Mr. Speaker, let's just go over what we have done and understand that the reason that we are going through this process, Mr. Speaker, is that we must invest in infrastructure around the province. There's infrastructure, there are infrastructure needs in every part of this province, Mr. Speaker, and the two go hand in hand. We're broadening the ownership of Hydro One in order to be able to leverage that asset, retain 40% ownership, Mr. Speaker, keep the regulatory controls in place, keep the process whereby hydro rates are set now by the Ontario Energy Board, but at the same time, Mr. Speaker, allow us to invest in the infrastructure that is needed. And that is what we have talked about in our 2014 budget, Mr. Speaker. It's what we talked about in our platform when we went to the people of Ontario, Mr. Speaker. We held technical briefings for both opposition parties. We talked about it throughout the election campaign. We made it very clear, Mr. Speaker, that we were looking at assets to leverage them in order to be able to invest in infrastructure.
Speaker, every day the Liberals' powerful friends are working to seal the deal on this $9 billion privatization. Every day the Premier refuses to be open and accountable to the people of Ontario. And every day she ignores the fact that this Liberal government still has no right to sell off our Hydro One. This Premier actually thinks she is entitled to privatize Hydro One with no public support, no public mandate, and no public scrutiny.
Well, Mr. Speaker, you know, as I've said in this House, we've worked very hard to make sure that the protections that must be in place for the people of Ontario are in place, and that the people of Ontario retain enough control, Mr. Speaker, of Hydro One, that they can, for example, remove the board. The government can remove the board. Major decisions that will be made by the board have to have two-thirds support, Mr. Speaker, and the government will have, the people of Ontario will have 40% control on that board. So those protections we have put in place. What I would say to the Leader of the Third Party, Mr. Speaker, is how can she
given that she purports to understand the needs of this province, how can she so underestimate the need to invest in infrastructure that she would say, stop building, stop investing, just at a time
Answer.
When we need that economic driver, Mr. Speaker?
Final supplementary.
Speaker, over generations, Ontarians have built our hydro system. Over generations, we've made sure that Ontarians are in charge.
Sorry, Minister of Agriculture is warned. Carry on.
Over generations, we've made sure that Ontarians are in charge and in control. Because that's important, Speaker. That is important to the families and to the businesses of this province. But now, this Premier is responsible for the biggest rollback of accountability in the history of Ontario's power system. She is selling off Hydro One with no mandate, Speaker, with no hearings, with no popular and public support, no public oversight, Speaker. Will this Premier finally admit that she sees openness and transparency as the biggest threat to her privatization scheme?
Oh, Mr. Speaker, you know, the leader of the third party knows that we have put in place protections. We have brought in Denis Desautels, the former AG of Canada, to oversee the IPO, Mr. Speaker. She knows that Hydro One will be regulated by the Ontario Business Corporations Act, the Ontario Securities Act, and the Ontario Energy Board.
But member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek is warned.
What the leader of the third party, I think, would like people to believe is that Hydro One is the same company as it was 40 years ago. And, Mr. Speaker, what she hasn't been saying is that we already have a mixed system, that there already are many, many people in this province, Mr. Speaker, who are not served by.
The member from Renfrew-Nipissing Pembroke is warned. Carry on.
That the system is already mixed, Mr. Speaker, that there already are private companies, municipal utilities who deliver, who have the distribution and the responsibility for transmission, Mr. Speaker. And I think that that's a nuance that she has chosen to ignore as she talks about what we are doing. And she also has chosen to ignore the fact that we are investigating.
Thank you. New question, the leader of the third party.
Mr. Speaker, newsflash to the Premier. It was public 40 years ago, and it is public now. She's the one that's changing that. And my question to the Premier is quite direct. She likes to say that she has had a choice to make, that somehow this is all about just a choice she had to make. But Ontarians know that a choice between public hydro and transit and infrastructure investment is a false choice. The truth is the Premier could have made better choices, Speaker, to fund transit and infrastructure. She could have made the kind of choices that New Democrats have been calling for. For example, restoring fair corporate taxes in the province of Ontario. Closing new corporate tax loopholes that this Liberal government put in place for CEOs to write off the HST on their luxury box seats. So here's the real question. Why is this Premier choosing to protect
Thank
the
you.
Interests of her powerful friends instead of the interests of the public?
Stop the clock. In case you didn't think I noticed, I finally figured out the member from Newmarket Aurora is warned. Carry on.
I think we just got an insight into the philosophy of the leader of the third party. She would like us to move back 140 years when nobody needed broadband, Mr. Speaker, when there were no transit needs, Mr. Speaker, in many of our urban municipalities. Mr. Speaker, we're not going to live 140 years ago. We've moved on, and we need to make the investments that are needed in 2015 going forward. The fact is, Mr. Speaker, 24% of the province's distribution is delivered by Hydro One.
Holy
it is a mixed company. It is very different. It's a mixed system. It's very different than it was 100 years ago, 50 years ago, 140 years ago. We're in 2015, Mr. Speaker. We need to make the investments that are needed in 2015 and that are needed for 2020 and 2030. If the leader of the third party doesn't want to come with us, Mr. Speaker, that's her prerogative. But the people of Ontario need those investments.
Seated, please. Final supplementary.
Speaker, it's only my second.
Supplementary.
This premier is making the wrong decisions, Speaker, for families, for businesses, and for the future of the province of Ontario. She is plowing ahead with the sale of Hydro One, even though Ontarians overwhelmingly reject this scheme. She's removing public oversight. She's rolling back accountability in our electricity system, Speaker. This is not the right direction, and she is using a false choice, Speaker, a false choice between public hydro and infrastructure investment to deliberately cater to her small group of powerful friends. How can this premier, how can she put the best interests of her friends ahead of the best interests of Ontarians?
Well, sorry, Mr. Speaker, but by my powerful friends, I don't know whether the leader of the third party means the mom who needs to get on LRT in order to be able to pick up her kids from daycare, or by my powerful friends, whether she means the young family in Barrie that have jobs in Toronto and want to be able to go back and forth, or whether she means the family in Hamilton, Mr. Speaker, who needs to get across the city in decent time. If that's who she means by my powerful friends, they are powerful. They're the people of Ontario.
Final supplementary.
Speaker, it's easy for this premier to make those kind of comments. If they were so damn powerful, she should listen to them and not come up with them. This premier had a choice to make, and we know exactly what she decided to do. She could have kept her promise, because she made it, to keep Hydro One in public hands, but she chose to break that promise. She could have been open and transparent every single step of the way, but she chose to keep the people of Ontario in the dark. And even better, she could have found smart ways to fund transit and infrastructure, like restoring fair corporate taxes and closing loopholes for corporations. But she chose to sell off a public asset.
The member from Eglinton Lawrence is warned. Please finish.
Public asset that belongs to all Ontarians, Speaker. Why does this premier keep choosing to put the interests of her small group of powerful friends ahead of the best interests of Ontario?
Thank you, Premier.
Speaker, let's be clear that the leader of the third party has put forward one alternative, and that is only to increase corporate taxes. That is the only thing she has put forward, Mr. Speaker. And what she is saying is that she is proposing that she would raise corporate taxes enough so that we could pay for all of the infrastructure, the Barrie line, the Kitchener line, Mr. Speaker, that we would pay for the Hamilton LRT, $1 billion for the Hamilton LRT, the new alignment of Highway 7 between Kitchener and Guelph, Highway 1117, four-laning between Thunder Bay and Nipigon, that the LRT, the second phase of the LRT in Ottawa, the EA for high-speed rail
from Hamilton Mountain,
you're warned. That all of that she would fund through increases in corporate taxes. Well, I would put to her, Mr. Speaker, if she were to do that, then the whole discussion about the economic competitiveness and viability of this province would change, Mr. Speaker. We would not be drawing direct investment, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The member from Prince Edward Hastings is warned. New question. The member from Alderman Norfolk.
To the Minister of Agriculture, 28,000 members of grain farmers of Ontario have been forced by your government to go to court seeking an immediate stay of your regulation banning neonics. Peggy Breckveld, a Thunder Bay dairy crop farmer, vice president, Ontario Federation of Agriculture, charges your regulations are unworkable, and I quote, "We will be required to have a certified crop advisor inspect our fields. There's only about 100 certified crop advisors that are qualified to do these inspections. Minister, your regs question the integrity of consulting agronomists, disqualifying those who work with the seed trade. Where are you going to find sufficient crop advisors who are not associated with Ontario's seed trade sector?"
Minister of Agriculture.
Mr. Speaker, for you, I want to thank the member for his question this morning from Haldimand Norfolk. Clearly, over the last little while, Mr. Speaker, we have identified four key areas that have put stresses on pollinators in the province of Ontario. We've identified over the last two winters that have been extremely cold, which has an impact on our pollinators in Ontario. We do know that there are mites that invade beehives in the province of Ontario, the Varroa mite. Thirdly, there is the management of hives in the province of Ontario, those hives that are professionally managed and those hives that are managed by hobbyists in that area. And fourthly, we do know the blanket use of Neodec application in the province of Ontario is having an impact on the health of pollinators right across the province of Ontario. And just recently, Mr. Speaker, we've embarked, along with our agricultural partners, a general pollinator strategy for the province of Ontario. It's the way to go forward.
Thank you. I just want to remind, as I reminded others, make sure that it's to the chair and he'll take it up.
To the regs, and farmers do want to know just who is standing up for farming at the cabinet table. Amended Reg 6309 indicates that all treated corn and soybean seed is now registered as a Class 12 pesticide. So to characterize a treated seed as a pesticide and therefore regulate the seed, not the pesticide, is unacceptable. It's unnecessary. It's inappropriate. You will cause significant and irrevocable economic damage without any clear evidence of any offsetting benefit for pollinators. Yet another reason farmers realize your regulatory process is simply unworkable. Minister, why would you, as Ontario's Minister of Agriculture, regulate a seed itself as a pesticide?
Minister?
Mr. Speaker, I certainly want to thank the member for his supplement, but I want to know where the official opposition stands in defending supply management in the province of Ontario. I want to know where the official opposition stands of providing 60% by the Government of Canada to make our risk management program whole for all the farmers of the province of Ontario. But thirdly, Mr. Speaker, I want to quote about some people who are agronomists in this area. Greg Stewart, the official agronomist for Mazac Seeds, said, purchasing treated seed when needed, it's not too difficult. DeKalb economist Bob Thurlow said, the process isn't as onerous as some growers think. We've talked about it with a few growers. It is any more work than the paperwork for having insecticide applied by airplane. We decided it is less work. Ken Curran from Pride Agronomist, we are encouraging growers to have that discussion with their agronomists, what acres need it and what acres they don't. This is what I'm hearing from grassroots farmers in the province of Ontario.
Thank you. New question, member from Windsor West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. For more than a year, this Liberal government has failed to reach new collective agreements with all of our dedicated teachers and education workers. Last week, the government failed again and talks collapsed with elementary teachers. The only way for this government to reach a deal is to be at the table, taking part in genuine and meaningful negotiations. When will this Premier send her minister back to the bargaining table?
Thank you, Premier. Minister of Education.
Thank you very much, and I'm very pleased to report, Speaker, that after very long and prolonged talks, we in fact have reached agreements, as you know, tentative agreements, with the English Catholic teachers and with the Ontario Secondary School teachers. We are bargaining as we speak with the Francophone teachers, and I'm quite optimistic. We understand that each of our sectors is a little bit different, that the French sector is different from the English sector, that the public sector is different from the Catholic sector, that the secondary panels different from the elementary panel. And for that reason, the conversations that we've had with each of our four unions, and I would like you to know that we've actually spent a lot of time with ETF.
Thank you. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. The Minister of Education says it takes thousands of hours of negotiating to reach tentative deals. But to make that happen, to reach those agreements, the government needs to show leadership and actually be at the bargaining table. And once it's at the table, the government needs to negotiate in a genuine and meaningful way, rather than trying to impose deals just to help the federal Liberal Party. Why is the Premier refusing to get back to the bargaining table and get back to real negotiations?
Minister?
Yes, and Speaker, I have no idea where the notion has come from, raised by the NDP and the union, that this has anything to do with the federal government. The reason that we have put a complete package before the elementary teachers is because, in fact, they have been on strike since May 11th. And that has caused disruption to our students. Our students have not had their EQAO tests. They didn't get their report cards. Their parents aren't meeting their teachers, and they're not having the field trips they would normally have. We want the disruption to stop, and that's why we tried to speed up the process with the elementary teachers, is because we want to get the elementary system back to the way it should be. We are absolutely, Speaker, willing to talk about how to find the deal.
New question? The member from Beaches East Shore.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Associate Minister of Finance. Over the summer, I've had the opportunity to speak to many people in the riding of Beaches East York about the issues that concern them the most. And what I've heard is that there is a growing anxiety about retirement security. Quite simply, the CPP does not work for seniors who do not have outside independent third-party pension plans. So many in my riding, particularly those in their 20s and 30s, do not have access to a workplace pension and are concerned about their futures. They worry that they will not be able to maintain the same standard of living in retirement, or they may outlive their savings. And they know seniors who are suffering from exactly that situation. And that is why so many Ontarians are very supportive of our government's plan to bring in the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. And my constituents are very eager to learn more about the plan and how it affects them. So over the summer, I know the Premier and the Minister announced details about the ORPP, and I would like, Mr. Speaker, if the Minister would please explain to us the new detail.
Thank you. Associate Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Beaches East York for that very important question. Mr. Speaker, Ontario is leading on this important issue. We are creating the ORPP to help close the retirement savings gap. Our goal is by 2020, every employee in Ontario would be part of the ORPP or comparable workplace pension plan. When we talk about comparable plan, we mean registered workplace pension plans like defined benefit plans and defined contribution plans. These plans will need to meet minimum contribution thresholds and provide locked-in benefits. And with these thresholds, we can confidently say that workers will be able to achieve similar benefit provided by the ORPP. We developed our approach by listening to people. We developed our approach by listening to business. Mr. Speaker, this design ensures that all Ontarians can have access to the retirement security that they deserve.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for that fine answer. She's doing an excellent job in giving us the security and retirement that we all need. I know that the constituents in my riding of Beaches East York will be glad to hear about these specific steps our government is taking to ensure all Ontarians will have access to secure retirement. So in recent months, I've also spoken with many local business owners about the ORPP, and many of them are very pleased to see that the government is introducing this plan that will give an affordable way for them to provide their employees with a meaningful pension. In these meetings, businesses have emphasized the importance of having time to plan for the introduction of the ORPP. And I know the minister has engaged with business extensively and that they have been active participants in that consultation process on the ORP earlier this year. So, Mr. Speaker, again, through you to the Associate Minister of Finance, will the minister please outline the steps our government has taken to help businesses plan for the introduction of the ORP?
Thank you, Minister.
And I want to thank the hard-working member for that important question. Mr. Speaker, the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan, the ORPP, is an investment in a secure retirement future for all Ontarians. That's not just individuals, that's business as well. Over the past several months, I've met with representatives from across the business community throughout Ontario. We heard that businesses and employees need time to plan. That is why we announced that we will be enrolling employers in stages, beginning with the largest employers in 2017. This coincides with expected reductions in EI premiums. We also announced that we will be phasing in contributions over 3 years. Mr. Speaker, the Ontario Chamber of Commerce said, "Our approach is a step in the right direction."
Wow.
Throughout the ORPP and through its implementation,
answer.
We are investing in our collective futures, which is good for all businesses in Ontario.
Thank you. New question, member from Lambton-Kitt-Middlesex.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question today is for the Minister of Finance. Minister, in January, this Liberal government made significant changes to Ontario's estate administration tax. The $143 million death tax on grieving families is nothing more than another cash grab. Minister, one of the changes made is to force estate trustees, usually the children of the deceased or the grieving widow, to provide a detailed list of their loved one's assets and a description of their value to you within days of losing their loved one. Minister, where is this government's compassion?
Here, here.
Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, interesting question, but let me be very clear to you, Mr. Speaker, directly to you, because I don't think they listen on the other side. It reads as follows. The government has not introduced a new tax on estates, has not changed the amount of estate tax administration payable, or the way that this tax is calculated, Mr. Speaker. All we are doing is ensuring...
The member from Glengarry, Ruscliffe-Russell, will withdraw.
Draw, Speaker.
Carry on.
Speaker, the regulation ensures that the government has the information needed to perform the audits and verify that the correct amounts of the tax have been paid. All we're doing, Mr. Speaker, is ensuring that the procedure takes place. Thank you.
Well, not very much compassion there, Mr. Speaker. Back to the Minister of Finance. Minister, family farms or small businesses can give rise to a death tax amounting to many tens of thousands of dollars. This is a debt that, when coupled with the income tax levied on capital gains, may force the next generation to sell the family business. Minister, you've already collected a lifetime of taxes on these assets. The Liberal view may be that small businesses and family farms are nothing more than money laundering operations for the rich, but we in the PC caucus recognize how vital Ontario's entrepreneurs and farmers are to Ontario's economy. Minister, I ask you, is there no better way to balance the books in the province of Ontario?
I would offer this as advice, third person, which means you're not talking to the minister, you're talking to the chair. Just as a reminder, we're going to try to get that done right this time.
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite and the PC caucus should well understand the process because it was them that introduced the EAT in 1998. They introduced this administrative tax. All we're saying, Mr. Speaker, is that the regulation does not change the court process. The EAT is collected by the court staff, and the new requirements will not change the court process or the amounts of tax payable. Mr. Speaker, they're the ones that introduced it. We're just making certain that it gets implemented correctly. That's all.
Thank you. New question, the member from Essex.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Speaker, yesterday we learned that a top Infrastructure Ontario executive had admitted to defrauding York University. Instead of being fired, he was put in charge of procuring a stadium for York University. We also learned that as early as January 2012, Infrastructure Ontario's chief risk officer knew about the fraud, but the fraud remained a secret outside of Infrastructure Ontario. Today we learned that CEO David Livingston knew about the fraud, the same David Livingston who became Dalton McGuinty's chief of staff and is being investigated by the OPP in his role in a cover-up. Yesterday, when I asked the minister if David Livingston knew about the fraud, he refused to answer. Speaker, did the minister really not know, or did Infrastructure Ontario keep that information away from him as well?
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Minister of Education. Minister of economic development.
I could try.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I think the member's recollection of his question and the answer yesterday isn't entirely accurate, Mr. Speaker. The fact is the member did ask me a question yesterday, and I responded to the best of our knowledge. The board had not been informed of the particular circumstances. That remains the case, Mr. Speaker. We take this matter seriously, though. It is a serious matter, and it's one that I think we need to take very seriously. Infrastructure Ontario has appointed an independent law firm to review this matter, to review the time that this individual was employed at Infrastructure Ontario, as well as the circumstances of his departure. Mr. Speaker, there's also a forensic audit firm that's been hired to take a look at the transactions that have occurred. And I as well, Mr. Speaker, am in the process of retaining a third-party special advisor to be our eyes and ears over this process at the same time.
Thank you. Yeah. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, we now have evidence that senior officials at Infrastructure Ontario covered up the fact that one of its top executives had admitted to fraud. David Livingston says that he knew about the fraud and that he told the Infrastructure Ontario board. Board members, however, deny this completely. Someone is not telling the truth. We just don't know who. Last December, the minister asked us to trust Infrastructure Ontario when it claimed, without evidence, that $8 billion spent on public-private partnerships wasn't a waste of money. And now the minister wants us to trust Infrastructure Ontario to investigate its own cover-up. Will the minister, Speaker, will the minister call for a truly independent investigation of the culture of cover-ups that evidently exists within Infrastructure Ontario?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Rhetoric notwithstanding, this is a serious matter, Mr. Speaker, and we're doing, I think, what we need to do to get to the bottom of it. I said yesterday and I say today, there are unanswered questions surrounding the circumstances of this individual's departure, and there are some unanswered questions that we want to ensure are looked into, and that's surrounding his activities while he was with Infrastructure Ontario. Now, the actions in question, the alleged actions that this individual took with York University, were outside of his role with Infrastructure Ontario. But, Mr. Speaker, out of an abundance of caution and prudence, we want to make sure that during his time at Infrastructure Ontario, there were no further anomalies that can be identified, and that's why we're taking the third-party actions that we're taking. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. The member from Northumberland, Quinty West.
Well, thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Community and Social Services. Last month, I was pleased to be with you in Campbellford for an announcement of almost $400,000 over 2 years for a project that will offer additional in-home support for people with development disability in my riding in Northumberland, Quinty West. This community hub residential model is a collaboration between Community Living Campbellford Brighton and Campbellford Memorial Hospital, and will provide support to aging individuals with development disabilities in surrounding rural areas to allow for their continued independent living. Minister, this project is part of a broader Development Services Housing Task Force initiative that you mentioned in the House earlier this year. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please provide us with an update on the work of the Housing Task Force and the progress made for residential services in Ontario?
Yeah. Thank you, Minister of Community and Social Services.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member from Northumberland, Quinty West, for the question. I was really delighted to be in Campbellford last month to announce the funding for the Community Hub residential model, and also to be introduced to so many of my ministry's local stakeholders in the member's riding, showing really how deeply rooted he is in his community. I was also in Smiths Falls, Lanark County, to announce a project which will provide residential supports to developmentally disabled adults with complex medical needs so that they can also live independently. These projects are recommended by the Developmental Services Housing Task Force and are part of the recent announcement of 12 community-based housing initiatives for adults with developmental disabilities. Our government has committed up to $6 million over the next 2 years for demonstration or research projects, which includes $3.47 million to support these 12 recently announced projects.
Thank you. Supplementary.
I would like to thank the minister for outlining the work this government and your ministry has been doing. In my conversation with residents and leaders in my community, it's very clear the importance that access to residential services has on lives of the individuals living with disabilities and their families. There continues to be need for more creative residential options, and day support for respite service. This is a struggle that individuals and families in development service sectors has known for a long time. However, the government's $810 million investment is making a tremendous difference in the lives of thousands of Ontario. Mr. Speaker, can the Minister please elaborate how efforts like Development Service Housing Task Force will work toward creating more opportunities for Ontarians that value inclusion, choice, and independence for these vulnerable individuals in need?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And we know that many individuals with developmental disabilities have very unique needs, and that there is a demand for a broader range of housing solutions that address these individualized needs. So our challenge isn't just about finding more supports, it's about finding the right kinds of supports for each individual. The Developmental Services Housing Task Force was created to help find and encourage inclusive and creative housing solutions, which would expand the options and choices available to adults with developmental disabilities. I'd like to thank the hard work of the agencies, the families, the community partners, and the Housing Task Force members. We've had an opportunity to expand our knowledge and learn how creative partnerships can help us provide new housing support options. A second call for proposals for additional projects will be issued later this year. And, Mr. Speaker, I look forward to future creative partnerships that we can learn from, and if they can be seen, if we can replicate these across
Thank
the province
you.
To help more people in the community.
Your question, the member from Perry Sound Muskoka.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. Minister, the Fraser Institute's annual survey of mining companies has again placed Ontario near the back of the pack for mining jurisdictions. In the Investment Attractiveness Index, this year Ontario fell 9 places to 23rd in the world. The high cost of electricity in Ontario is continually cited as a key contributing factor in this slide.
Surprise.
This spring, the Association of Major Power Consumers in Ontario revealed that the hydro customer was ignored in your government's plan to sell off a majority stake of Hydro One. Members of AMCO employ thousands of people across northern Ontario. Minister, can you guarantee that the sale of Hydro One will not lead to increased electricity costs for industrial consumers in northern Ontario?
Thank you. Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, as the member knows well, Mr. Speaker, the Ontario remains the top jurisdiction for mineral exploration in the country, if not across the continent, and we're very, very proud of that, despite the challenges that we do see related to commodity pricing. The fact is that, indeed, we are also very proud of the fact that, although we recognize the challenge of energy pricing, early this year we made the Northern Industrial Electricity Rate Program a permanent program, which has been tremendous help to the resource-based sector in terms of reducing those energy costs. And may I say, with the time I have left, we also are still seeing, despite the challenges that are there, the number of mines in the province of Ontario that are continuing opening up being a very, very real positive. We're seeing operations certainly in Red Lake in terms of the on minerals, in terms of the Cochere expansion, the New Gold expansion, which I know the member knows well about. We are very, very proud of that and looking forward to a
supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, and you well know that the NEAR program only applies to a handful of companies. So again to the Minister. Minister, we've seen this story before. When jurisdictions become uncompetitive, companies pull out and take local jobs with them. When Xstrata Copper pulled up stakes in Timmins only to move across the border to Quebec, they cited uncompetitive hydro rates as a key motivating factor in the move. Northern Ontario lost 700 good-paying jobs. Minister, will the sale of Hydro One lead to more stories like that of Xstrata Copper and more jobs lost in Northern Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, it's actually rather unfortunate to hear the member sort of talking down what is really obviously a very positive industry in terms of the economy in Northern Ontario. When we see the fact that the mineral production in the province reached over $11 billion
Chair,
in 2014, up from $5.3 billion about 10 years previously, that's obviously a very positive sign. We don't deny that there are challenges, though. Certainly, we all know about the challenge related.
I ask the member, as I have asked others who are addressing the chair,
Excuse me, Mr. Speaker. I thought I was looking at you, but I now will indeed look at you and point out the fact that we are very, very enthused about the positive opportunities in the mining sector. Certainly, the Northern Industrial Electricity Rate Program is helping major resource sector producers in both the mining and the forestry side reduce their
energy costs,
which is allowing them to continue to make mines open up in the province of Ontario, which we are going to continue to see. We're very excited for the opportunities of the mining sector. Keep working.
Thank you. New question, the member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. This Premier's record on childcare just keeps getting worse, and families across Ontario are paying the price. Ontario has no comprehensive plan for childcare, no targets, no timelines. Most recently, the Premier backtracked on her support for the $15 a day childcare. The Premier has stood on the sidelines while public childcare centres close their doors in communities like Sarnia, Sudbury, Windsor, London. Peel Region closed their 12 regional centres as well. And now 5 public childcare centres are at risk of closure in Waterloo Region. Each of these 5 childcare centres has attained the triple gold standard Raising the Bar program for the last 12 years. They serve 250 children and their families. Every time we lose a public child care centre, we lose quality care for kids in this province and good jobs in our communities. Why is this Premier doing nothing to stop the closure of quality child care centres and doing nothing to stand up for child care that Ontario families so desperately need?
Yes, Speaker, and I'm very pleased to tell you that, I think the member opposite has misrepresented the data. In fact,
the minister will withdraw.
Misinterpreted, perhaps. But let me tell you what the data is, and then people can argue over how they feel about that. Since 2003, our government has almost doubled the provincial spending on child care. We are now up to over $1 billion in spending on child care. What that has allowed us to do is increase the number of licensed child care spaces in Ontario by 70%, so that we now have added 130,000 additional licensed child care spaces.
Thank you. Supplementary.
And to the Premier. On Monday, when our leader asked the Premier why she refuses to support making childcare more affordable, the Premier said, "We have no understanding of what that would mean to the people of Ontario." Well, parents across Ontario, they know exactly what quality, affordable childcare means. It means not being stuck on a wait list for a spot you can afford. It means knowing that your child has access to the safest care and with qualified professionals. There are approximately 3,800 families and children on Waterloo Region's wait list. Almost half of those families need immediate care right now. Yet the province sits on its hands while centres have been closed or privatized across the province. Will the Premier commit to a real plan for child care in Ontario that sets targets, that sets timetables to grow child care in this province, rather than overseeing the closure of yet more high-quality public centres across this province?
Thank you. Minister.
Speaker, what we have done since we were elected first in 2003 is we have introduced full-day kindergarten. We've created 130,000 new child care spaces.
Finish, please.
We've doubled the number, the amount of money that we're spending to over $1 billion. We've spent $120 million in building new child care spaces, new licensed child care spaces. We have made a huge, unprecedented investment in child care. And what we have said since the beginning, not just the beginning of the election, but the beginning of this story, is that when Mr. Mulcair said he was going to introduce a new program, he didn't say how he would
answer.
He didn't say what he was going to expect Ontario to pay for, because we know we've already made a huge investment, and we want to know what he's going to do to invest.
Stop the clock. Wow. New question. The member from Kingston in the Islands.
Is it like a yellow card?
Is it signed?
Speaker, we know that children's social environment is an important factor in determining whether they'll succeed academically, socially, and in the labour market. This is exactly why, one of the reasons why, for example, the Premier's Council on Youth Opportunities is such an integral part of youth engagement in bringing valued youth voices to the table. I was pleased to recommend the Premier's Council to the Kingston and the Islands this summer. Across the province, some children and youth experience more hardship than others. This is something that we all know in this House. Mr. Speaker, would the minister please explain what supports her ministry provides to ensure that at-risk youth are able to succeed?
Thank you. Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Speaker, first I want to thank the MPP from Kingston and the Islands for her fantastic work to support youth in her riding. Having our Premier's Council on Youth at Kingston being part of it is just great. And we all know, Speaker, when kids are at risk, we want to have the right support so that they can reach their full potential and make really positive choices for their future. So that's why we've taken a whole-of-government approach to serving and meeting the diverse needs of youth. And, Speaker, we've seen very, very positive results since the launch of our 2012 Youth Action Plan. We fulfilled all 20 recommendations of that plan. So now what we have are 27,500 youth facing barriers across Ontario who are now accessing new supports and opportunities.
Answer.
And the outreach, youth outreach program has been increased, and the Youth Opportunities Fund provides $5 million per year to support community projects for at-risk youth. Thank you, Speaker.
Speaker, I'm glad to hear that the minister is taking these issues seriously, and it's encouraging that the Youth Action Plan has been expanded. But I know that one of the main concerns for at-risk youth is that without proper supports and guidance, they may become involved in criminal activity. Programs like Youth Diversion in my riding of Kingston and the Islands focus on keeping promising youth out of the justice system where a criminal record can destroy the rest of their lives and erase the opportunity for a second chance. The staff and volunteers at Youth Diversion Program understand full well the value in extrajudicial measures, alternative court proceedings. Mr. Speaker, does the action plan address concerns about youth crime specifically?
Thank you. Minister.
Thanks again, Speaker. With the expansion of the current Youth Action Plan, we are providing $55 million over the next 3 years to address the root causes of youth violence and to focus on closing the gaps in service for youth at risk. That's a very substantial and historical investment. And we expect that the plan will create an additional 37,500 opportunities per year for children at risk. And to help young people enter the labour force, Speaker, we're partnering with training colleges and universities to invest $250 million over the next 2 years for the Youth Job Strategy. That focuses on skill development for young people and making sure they're making the right connections to where the jobs are, Speaker. We're very committed to
doing
this important work and providing wonderful opportunities for Ontario's youth at risk, and we want to continue to get the root cause of violence.
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker.
Any questions, the member from Prince Edward Hastings?
Thank you very much, Speaker. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Natural Resources this morning. Joe Crowley, Speaker, is the Minister's species at risk expert, and he testified less than 2 weeks ago at an environmental review tribunal in Prince Edward County that he recommended against issuing a permit for wind turbines to kill, harm, and harass endangered species on the south shore of Prince Edward County. What did the Minister's office do? They granted the permit anyway. But when the minister and the ministry experts recommended against a project in the minister's own riding back in 2011, just before the election that year,
tell me it isn't.
The ministry couldn't kill that project fast enough. So the ministry's own experts have confirmed that politics and not science is guiding what wind turbine projects are allowed to kill endangered species in the province. Speaker, will the minister overturn the anti-scientific decision that was made and revoke the permit it gave to Gilead and Prince Edward County and do it?
Thank you. And so have you. Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry.
Thank you, and I want to thank the member for the question. I think it's interesting what's going on here. We know very clearly that this particular party in opposition is not in favour of our renewable energy projects that are going on across the province of Ontario. And we also know very clearly, I think we can state with some definition, that they're also not in favour of the Endangered Species Act legislation that we brought forward some time ago, Speaker. The beauty of this question, and I've had one like this before, is now we see the opposition party's position where they want to try and use Endangered Species Act legislation to prevent a wind turbine project going forward that I think perhaps they don't on the ground support. So they have these two conflicting pieces of legislation, one which will can stop or allow a project to go forward. Both of these projects, this one and another one, Speaker, are still before the Environmental Review Tribunal. There's not a lot I can say specifically on them, but I will speak more, Speaker, in the supplementary in terms of what detail I can.
Thank you, supplementary.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Back to the Minister for Natural Resources and Forestry. Minister, your government has a track record of hiding inconvenient truths. From cancelled gas plants to e-health to Orange, the Liberal name has become synonymous with scandal, and it doesn't stop at Ostrander Point, unfortunately. We have learned just last week your government is up to your same old tricks, just so you can...
To the chair, please.
Speaker, this old, tired government is up to the same old tricks because they want to cover Ontario's landscapes with costly, unwanted industrial wind turbines.
Yep.
So, back to the minister. Minister, Barbara Ashby, Lori Gillis, Ted Whitmore, Bill Palmer, the list goes on. Communities across Ontario want to know, Speaker, why does this Liberal government continue to blatantly disregard scientific evidence in order to ensure industrial wind turbines continue?
Thank you. Minister?
Speaker, thank you. Speaker, all renewable energy projects in the province of Ontario receive their approval to move forward through the Ministry of the Environment and Climate Change. All of them. They make an application, they get a FIT contract from the Ministry of Energy, they get their broader based approval from the Ministry of Environment and Climate Change. The projects in question have received those approvals. When it comes to our particular ministry, we get involved where necessary when it comes to endangered species. If an endangered species is found to be on the site, we then play a role on the ground, district by district, we make the decisions on whether or not there is an endangered species present, and if there is, on a district by district basis, they make a decision on whether or not we are able to mitigate on both the habitat and on the species. That's exactly what's happened in this case.
Answer.
That's why we provided an overall benefit in both cases, Speaker, and that's what we did on a district basis here. Nothing, Speaker, secretive about anything that's going on.
Pursuant to the Standing Order 38A, I wish to advise you that my dissatisfaction with the response of the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs to my question on mnemonic regulations. The reason for my dissatisfaction is, in my view, there's not enough time for a fulsome answer to a detailed technical issue. The member from Haldimand, Norfolk. Pursuant to Standing Order 38A, the member for Prince Edward Hastings has given notice of his dissatisfaction with the answer to his question given by the Minister of Natural Resources concerning wind turbine process. The matter will be debated today at 6 p.m. The previous one will be debated today at 6 p.m. as well. Minister of Agriculture, on a point of order.
Order. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. In our gallery today, I take great pleasure of introducing Wendy and Mike Radden, from the wonderful riding of Lambton, Kent, Middlesex, the parents of my wonderful legislative assistant, Mackenzie Radden. We welcome them here today.
There being no further deferred votes, this House stands adjourned until 3 p.m. this afternoon. 1, 3, 3.